say yes. You lead the way. I'm not afraid of what it means for me to say that this life you gave is not my own. I'm trusting you to hear my yes and lead me on. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. My life is yours.
I'll just say yes.
Yes, Lord.
You lead the way.
Yes, Lord.
I'm not afraid of what it means for me to say.
But this life you gave.
Yours,
and
there is
say yes, you lead the way. I'm not afraid of what it means for me to say that this life you gave is not my own. I'm trusting you to hear my yes and lead me on. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. My life is yours.
I'll just say yes.
Yes, Lord.
You'll lead the way.
Yes, Lord.
I'm not afraid of what it means for me to say.
But this life you gave is not my own.
Not my own.
Oh.
I'm trusting you to hear my yes and lead me on.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
My life
is yours.
Yes, Lord.
Good evening and welcome. My name is Steve O'Neill, and on behalf of Visitation Parish, St. Francis Xavier Parish, and our Joint Social Concerns Committee, I want to welcome you to tonight's Hunger Banquet. We are honored you could join us and are grateful for the willingness of our speaker, Rosilyn Temple, founder and director of Kansas City Mothers in Charge. She's here to share her personal story and to educate us on the issue of homicide in Kansas City. It was about a year ago that our Social Concerns Committee decided to ask Rosalind to share her story and provide education for tonight's Hunger Banquet. At that time, we could never have imagined the exponential rise in homicides in our nation and in our Kansas City community. This really shows the importance of having a speaker like Rosalind come to our parish to educate, provide resources, and also explain ways we as a community can help. In a minute, Mary Ann McCormley of St. Francis Parish will lead us in a prayer, and then Jenny Green from the Visitation Social Concerns Committee will introduce our speaker. But first, I'd like to go over the layout of the evening and provide a few housekeeping details. So we will be recording the session tonight, so this can be shared and viewed by others at a later time, and the recording will be able to be available on our parish YouTube channel, Visitation TV. Second, there will be a Q&A session after Rosalind's presentation. You'll have the ability throughout the session to submit questions, and you do this by typing them into the Q&A section at the bottom of your screens. If someone asks a question that you are particularly interested in having answered, you can push the thumbs up icon to move the question to the top of the list. At the end of the presentation, Jenny will conduct a Q&A session using the questions submitted. And third, most importantly, we are accepting a free will offering for KC Mothers in Charge. If you want to make a contribution toward the good work Rosalind and her team are doing in Kansas City, you can go to the Visitation Parish website at visitation.org, scroll down and click on the online giving button. You'll then enter your amount in the other category and specify that this donation is for KC Mothers in Charge. Lastly, following the program, we'll be sending out an email to all participants containing helpful information and resources cited, so don't worry if you can't catch everything tonight. Now, I'm going to pass the program over to Mary Ann, who will lead us in prayer. Following this prayer, Jenny Green, who's tonight's moderator, will come on and introduce our guest speaker. Mary Ann.
Good evening. Let's take a moment. Take a breath to let go of all of the busyness of this cold day and to come into this present moment. Let's center ourselves, anchor ourselves, and be mindful of God's ever-present love for us. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, you love us with a mother's love. You gently gather us together like a mother hen gathers her chicks under her wings. Let us rest here a moment and remember your love for us. Let us remember your love for all of us. Let us remember especially your love for our Black and Brown brothers and sisters in Kansas City's inner city who die from homicide. You gather us together tonight to listen to our sister Rosalyn, give her strength, courage, and comfort as she shares her truth, the truth, that too many suffer and die. Give us open ears and open hearts to hear her truth and her challenge. As we gather tonight for this Hunger for Justice banquet, we thank you for feeding us, not with a banquet of soup and bread, but a banquet of stories and hope. Amen.
Good evening, I'm Jenny Green. I'm with the Visitation Social Concerns Committee. And I welcome all of us, all of you who are joining us tonight. We're grateful for your presence and we're grateful to have this opportunity to come together and listen to Rosalyn's story. Rosilyn Temple, our distinguished guest, turned an unspeakable personal tragedy, the murder of her son, into a life's mission to help others experiencing this same nightmare. In 2012, Rosilyn founded Casey Mothers in Charge to support the families and loved ones of victims of homicide. Rosilyn and the members of KC Mothers in Charge are often some of the first people to arrive on the scene to provide critical support to families of this tragedy. KC Mothers in Charge not only provides this immediate support, but continue to work with these families on a long-term and ongoing basis to help families process and recover after a violent loss. In 2015, Rosilyn was awarded the Kansas City Star's Editorial Board's Citizen of the Year in recognition of her critically important work. Rosilyn and Casey Mothers in Charge have made a huge impact on the Kansas City community, and we are so honored to have her here tonight. Before Rosilyn begins, we're going to watch a short trailer for a film that was made about Rosilyn and her and the Casey Mothers in Charge. It's titled Uncommon Allies. After the trailer, we'll then hear from Rosilyn, which I'm looking forward to. Thank you.
No mother should bury her child.
Today has been a very violent day here in Kansas City. We need your help, Kansas City. If anyone knows anything that happened in any of these cases today, we urge you, we plead with you today to call us.
Someone knows who killed my son, and I need answers.
Who would take a 26-year-old life and just leave them in their own apartment and lock them in there like they're animals?
My family is not going to get no closure. And see, whoever killed my brother is behind bars.
There's 80 dead Black folks in the city, and I don't have a single protest, a single national media coverage for anyone.
We got to love on each other. It's not the police killing us. It is us doing it.
If we are to believe that police departments are as bad as the media or segments of the community would lead us to believe, the streets would be running red with blood. There are more good things happening with police departments and police officers every day that no one ever reports about.
When I think about urban Kansas City, it's in a state of chronic and unrelenting stress and trauma.
It's like a slow and gradual breakdown in the fabric of society. I could not even begin to tell you what the problem is or how to fix it.
I don't want no other mother to go through what I've been through. I had to be a mother to take a stand. So now with Kansas City Mothers in Charge, I'm called to homicide scenes. I'm first responder with the homicide detectives. I'm there to bridge that gap with the community and the police department.
Rosalyn has taken on a huge undertaking. She's literally taken this city on her shoulders to help the victim families navigate this process.
It's okay to cry. It's okay to cry. It's okay.
Everybody looks at her like, kind of like a mother. She remembers everything that we do, everything we say. I don't know how she does it.
See, the police department, I always kind of joke around a little bit and tell them, all I need is a light. So I guess, you know, let my window up, throw the light on top and just go on through the lights and turn my siren on.
This is a mother who has been there. Not only has she been there for her own, she's been there for countless others who have had the same problem. That's the type of connectivity that we have to have in this city if we're going to end the violence.
We're going to take Kansas City back. We're going to support our police department. They can't do it by themselves. They cannot do it by themselves, y'all.
The community has to have their Martin Luther King, John F. Kennedy moment where you say, enough is enough, and you fight for what you believe.
Everybody has something unique to bring. Everybody's not going to be a Rosilyn Temple, but you be whoever you're supposed to be and help me fight this fight.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Rosalyn Temple. I am the founder and the program director of KC Mothers in Charge. 2011, November 23rd, was Thanksgiving Eve. My son, Antonio Thompson, who was only 26 years old, was found murdered in his apartment. Prior to that, you know, I've never thought, lived in Kansas City all my life, born and raised, did a lot of things in my life that was not of the law. Had a lot of different things, battles I struggled through before this even occurred for my son. I had 22 years addicted to crack cocaine, in prison a couple of times, served a couple prison sentences. You know, I never thought that I can come out of that addiction. I can come out of the lifestyle. You know, remember seeing the police department come on, be on my area, my neighborhood, and my community. And I would always be angry and wonder why the police was on my block. Didn't want to see them because I was not doing what I supposed to be doing as a citizen of Kansas City. So, you know, just living this life of destruction, not able to function in a manner like that I should have been, you know, had children, different things was going on, you know, wasn't able to take care of my kids a couple of times. So, you know, raised by a single Black mother, I'm the oldest of seven children. My mother struggled with a lot of mental health issues, we had to go and stay with my grandmother, which basically took me in as the old. I was the oldest, and I had a lot of responsibilities on me to take care of my younger siblings and stuff. But once my grandmother took me in, she forced me into the church, and you know, back in them days, you know, older. Our elders, they believed in going to church, and you had to go to church, you live their home. And so, you know, she instilled some things in me that I never knew that would stick with me until as I got older and kind of started growing up and going through this battling drug addiction, battling prostitution, things that I was doing in my community. And so I remember, you know, my last days just struggling, you know, with this addiction, you know, living in abandoned houses, no running water, went through a lot, lost all the things I had. And so I remember my last day, I remember I was staying with my sister. She had came back in town. They was in the process of doing an intervention on me. So I remember just sitting in her basement, and she had her basement fixed up for me, and my sister was saved. You know, my siblings, they did really well. You know, my mother died at the age of 41, and I was in my 20s. So remember, my sister gave me this Bible, and she told me to read the Bible, and I was just reading the Bible, and my mind was just racing. you know, that addiction, all the things I've been through. And I just knew I couldn't even hold a train of thought. Remember when my grandmother instilled in me and kept me in church, and I knew God, you know, and I love God. I knew God was real. And so, you know, I would always give God certain things I wanted him to help me with. Once I got on my feet, I would say, oh God, I got this. And I started doing Rosalind Way. And see, Rosalind Way never sustained. It never lasted long. So these last days, you know, I sit in my sister's basement like I was going to lose my mind. And so I said, God, I need you. I trust you. I just need you to help me. Heard about you giving people cars and houses and just giving them a new store. I need you to renew this because my mind was not staying instructed. It was just racing. So I remember hearing God that said, try my way. You'll never look back. It was like the beautifulest whisper I ever heard. And I surrendered my life right then and there to God in 07. And I never looked back. But, you know, going through things, and I was so sold out for God, and people say, oh, you Jesus this. You know, people call you Jesus because everything, I just fell in love with God. Because God loved me when I couldn't love myself. And God kept me when I couldn't do nothing for myself. So I remember just getting a job, and oh, God opened so many doors for me. I remember getting this one job, and I was through a temporary service, and it's like five of us started at the same time. It was this a Caucasian, a young girl. She was younger than me. She was in her 20s, and we started at the same time, and I didn't have a car because my brother-in-law and my sister was taking me to work and picking me up from Missouri to Kansas. And so she told me, she said, I have a car. I have a clear title that you can have. I just don't know what's wrong with the car. And so I remember my brother-in-law going, she said, they can come with the car, they can tow it. He went and got the car and towed the car back and come and found all it was a water pump that cost $40. And I this young lady gave me a car, and I never knew, I've never seen her back at the job for that day. So I know God has angels. God will put people in places to do things that will bring you from some things. And God was showing up and showing out in my life. So I remember going to Bible study with my family. We had Bible study. And my uncle, some years ago, he had lost my 15-year-old cousin. His son was at school running track and just passed out and had a massive heart attack. And him and his wife were sold out for God. I remember when that happened to his son, they had some battles that they went through. And they struggled, and they married, even split up. I remember my uncle in the Bible, so he told me, he said, you sold off a guy. He said, things might change if you lose a child. And I told him right then, I said, if I lose a child, I'm still trust God. I trust him. I know God got me. And my uncle spoke that to me twice. So in 2011, my son Antonio Thompson was found murdered in his apartment. So I had got my house and stuff, and I was doing pretty good on my feet. I remember my son calling me, whom I call Pee Wee. He called me and one day and said, Mom, I got my first apartment. So I told Pee Wee to keep that place. You got to go get a job. You got to do the right things in life. And so I remember, you know, I had got a job at Plastic Packaging Technology. I worked in 12-hour shifts. I was a machine operator. So my job consumed my life. I was at work more than I was at home. I worked from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m., 3 days on, 2 off, it's a rotation. So I remember my son called me, said he had got that job and he got his apartment and stuff. So I remember I had worked that Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So I was off that Monday and Tuesday prior to Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving Eve was that Wednesday. I remember I woke up that Tuesday morning, and my middle name to my kids was tired because I was always tired. And that's what I preach. I was tired. I remember woke up that morning and my son Antonio's new apartment just moved like 10 blocks from my home. So I got him some clothes by 9 o'clock that morning, went down there, knocked on his door. He was like, Mom, what you doing up? Because he couldn't believe I was up. I said, Pee, we move over. I remember going to the apartment, sitting down on his couch, taking my shoes off. And we had a talk. And the things that my son told me he was so proud of me, how I changed my life together, that he loved me so much. And he said, Mama, I want to buy all your Thanksgiving food for Thanksgiving, but I'm a cook at home. I said, Pee, I couldn't believe you're not coming to my house. He said he wanted his new apartment, wanted to buy some friends over for us at his new apartment and have Thanksgiving dinner at home. So remember where he lived off of 47th and Cherry, Oak Hill Manor Apartments. I remember Sunfresh store, which is still there today on Blue Parkway. I remember going over there and buying all the food for Thanksgiving, getting his stuff. I remember calling Pee Wee from Sunfresh. I said, Pee Wee, I'm not going to get you no turkey. You know, as a mama, we just takes over all the time. We just got that mother, you know, with the mother love. And so I told myself, I'm not going to get you no turkey. I'll get you some Cornish hens because you're not going to have a really large crowd. He was like, okay, mama. So I remember taking all this food back to his apartment. So I had to go back to work that Wednesday, Thanksgiving Eve, and then I would have been off Thanksgiving. And so he wanted me to help him cook some things like his dressing and stuffing, his greens and sweet potatoes, things that we put together, touch as a mother. I remember taking his food back. And so I told Pee-wee, I said, I'm going home because I got to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning. And it came pretty quick. Like November, you go to work when it's dark, you come home when it's dark, the winter season. So I remember getting home. And I had my daughter's kids, because my daughter was incarcerated at the time, staying with me. So I remember getting home. So I remember Pee-wee calling me. He said, Mama, guess what? I said, what, Pee-wee? I said, I'm in the bed. I was getting that because I got in the bed real early. He said, I forgot to get a cheesecake I want to make from scratch. I need for you to come take me to the store. I said, Pee-wee, I got to go to work in the morning. I said, you know, I'll come early. He said, Mama, if you love me, you'll come. So I remember I told him, as soon as my grandkids got up from school, I'm going to call you, Pee-wee. I said, I'll call you. I'm going to come down there. I'm going to hunt. You got to be ready because you got to run the store and I got to get back home so I can get on time for work. So I remember my grandkids coming in from school and I called my son and said, well, I'm on my way. He said, Mama, that's okay. My friend came. I'll see you tomorrow when you get off of work. Remember going to bed. I remember waking up the next morning. I get up, you know, I got up so early. So I remember getting up. Every morning I got up, I pray and I worship God. I have my music. I read my Bible before I ever leave my house. The first thing I just always thank God for allowing me to see another day and the things that he had done for me and thank him for the bad for things that he was going to do for me. So I remember getting in my car, but that morning I felt like some heaviness was on me. It was like what a typical morning, but I'm still going to trust God. I remember getting in my car, going on to work. And my first break was at 8 o'clock and I called my son. You know, normally you call your kids, but I call them. If Pee Wee's on the phone, he'll slide me the voicemail, but he'll call me right back. So this morning I called him, his phone rang. He went to hit the ring back tone, that ring back tone song. So it would go to that. So every break and lunch break I had and breaks I had, I called him and he never answered the phone. So as a mama, you get pretty worried. So when I got up at 6 o'clock that evening, I got in my car and I called his phone. It went straight to voicemail. It's like someone knew my schedule. So I immediately called my nephew and a few friends on the highway that I knew that Pee Wee be with and that he talks to faithfully every day. And they said they had been trying to call him all the day they self. So I remember got in my home. I remember putting my pajamas on. First thing you do when you're cooking your Thanksgiving meal, you know, you get your bacon out the way. Remember my sweet potato pies in the oven. I remember my youngest son coming in from work and I asked him, have you talked to your brother? He said, no, he haven't talked to him. I said, well, go. I just had got a computer because back then, you know, I was old school. I wasn't going to do all this new technology things. Had a flip phone. I was going to do all of that. So I'm going to tell my son, go on that book stuff that y'all be on and see when the last time he put something on that book stuff. So my son went on Facebook, like, now I know it's Facebook, and he said, Mama's last night at 10:30, last time he posted something. So I had got the computer because of my job. I had to get a computer because I had to learn a few things, enter some things at my job as a machine operator. So I remember he said, yeah, last time he posted 10:30. So immediately my mama antennas went up. So I remember taking them pies to the oven and putting my turkey in the oven on slow. I took my granddaughter, got her ready. I put my boots on. I called a couple of friends I knew. I said, could y'all meet me down to his apartment? I got to go find my child. So I remember going down there. You know, it's Thanksgiving. It's lit up, you know. But getting in that apartment building was the main locked door. And you have to get in that locked door first. I remember walking around, knocking on people's windows, trying to get in that main, have somebody open that main door up. And people just even come to their windows, you know, and I felt that was just so strange because it was my window. You knock on my window. Now, I don't know if I'm going to come to. I'm definitely going to dial 911. But anyway, as we walked around and walked around, I seen a young man walk up the street. So I said, hey, come here. I said, how can I get in this building? And he said, ma'am, I knew the lock wasn't a good lock. You can tell that it wasn't a good lock at all. So he said, ma'am, all you gotta do is take a stick and move the lock back you get in. And you know, I was doing everything right in life. It wasn't right, but I asked him, could you do it for me? And he did. I remember him, I went into my son's apartment 202. I remember knocking on his door. I remember pulling the door, because back then they had them old deadbolt locks. When you leave, you lock the outside. And it was just tightly locked. So I'm in the hallway of this building. I look out this picture window, and you can see the office number, the after hour number. So I call this number, and I tell him, my name is Ron. I took my son, Antonio Thompson. He stays in the farm. I need for you to come and let me in. Go in and see if he's at home, because I'm looking for my child. It's like I got half his food at my house, half of his house. I was going to help him. After I got my dinner cooked, go down and help him get some of his stuff cooked. So remember, it was maintenance. He said, man, we can't come and let you in because you're not on the lease. I understood the law. I understood the process they had to do. So I hung up the phone, and I stood there a little while more, and I looked around. So I just dialed 911. I remember they said they were going to send someone out, and it didn't take them long at all. And they said a sergeant came out. For some reason, it was a sergeant. I told the sergeant everything, half his food in his apartment, half of it at my house. He was due to start his job December 3rd at H&R Block on Blue Parkway, where he can walk to work. If he didn't have a ride, he can get to work. And so I told the officer, I told the sergeant everything. So he called the after hour number, and they told him the same thing. They couldn't let them in. So he looked at me. I said, sir, I can't leave this building. I said, I don't have to go in. You all can go in and just go in. If he's not in there, I promise you, I will go home. I would finish my Thanksgiving. I would leave everybody alone. So he looked at me. He said, ma'am, I'm going to go ahead and do an early welfare check. So he called me. He said, I'm going to call the fire department. They're going to kick the door and we're going to go in. But when they get here, you got to go outside the whole building until we go in the apartment and see if he's in there. I remember the fire department taking them along. They got there. They came pretty quick. And I was standing outside, me and my granddaughter and a couple of friends. It was cold. I remember everything, like time just stopped. It's like life just stopped. And it just took him so long, it seemed like it was looking forever to come out. But when that sergeant walked out, the way he looked at me, he gave me a look. He said, ma'am, he's in there. He's been murdered. I just fell to the ground. I couldn't breathe. They called the fire department. They came out and gave me some oxygen. And when I got my breath, I said, Lord, I trust you. I said, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. You know, I trust God. I knew it wasn't an act of God. I knew God didn't do this, but I knew God saw all. He knew all. But one thing I was going to stand on his promise, and I was going to serve him, not going to trust him for the process. I remember police department came from everywhere. They wrote yellow tape my son's apartment off. And I remember it was just like a big boy, like a big hole, like in the street. My family came from everywhere, friends came from everywhere. They was on this side, police department on this side. And one thing I did, like a safety, I told them no one would mess with these men or women because I want them to give me the best investigation they got. I just didn't understand. It wasn't no one in the community out there to walk me through that process, to be there, support me. They found my son at 10:30 at night. And they didn't move him to 6 o'clock that morning. And when I looked around, it was no one out there but me, my youngest son, the media, and the police department. And I knew we had a problem in our community. I knew we had a chief of police just elected in a few months prior to my son, Antonio, being murdered. His name was Chief Daryl Forte. And he was coming out to all the homicides in the community when he was in town. I think that was pretty big as a chief of police, taking time to come on them scenes, but them homicide scenes in the community, build a community. So I knew I needed to speak to that man and talk to him. So I remember I buried my son on December 3rd, 2011, same day he was due to start his job. And so I started immediately calling Chief Daryl Forte's phone. I remember I would call several times a day. And so me and his secretary, Miss Liz, which still is the secretary today, became pretty good friends. She told me, she said, Miss Temple, I promise you, when I get that date and time, I will call you. You don't have to call. I'm not going to forget to call you. But I still called. I was persistent. So when she told me the day and time, I remember walking to Chief Daryl Forte's office. I told him I was Rosalyn Temple. My son was Antonio Thompson. I said, I need to go to homicide scenes. He looked at me and said, I've been looking for someone like you. See, I need to support the community, the families, police department, because it was a hole in our community. It was no one there to able to walk a family, to help a mother, father, grandmother, sister, someone that has been victimized, have just lost their loved one, to be able to walk them the process of what the Kansas City Police Department was doing, the different things they have to wait. I didn't understand. All I knew, it just took so long. So I went to my first homicide scene in 2013. I never did something that felt so right. I remember walking to the homicide scene and seeing this mama. And the first thing I went through is to the mama, and I gave her the biggest hug. And she seen me. And when you can tell someone, because if I would have had someone that year that would have came to my home, just knocked on my door, I never have to see this lady or person in my life. Instead, I experienced losing a child to homicide. I would just grab hold of me. Coming from a large family, I have a sister. I have six sisters. They were here. My sister was saying they know how I feel. I told them, no, you don't. You ain't got to say it no more, because I didn't know how I felt. I told them, your presence is good enough. Just be here. You know, cause I would just scream out. Because losing a child, that's something that just destroys the inside of you, that breaks your heart. Because you birthed that child in this world. You carried a child for 9 months. Labor pains as a woman. Do I know? I don't know how they feel. I know they hurt. So just imagine losing that child that you carry. So after I got my son, but one thing I knew, I needed to find something that Kansas City did not have. So I would go up to Ally Group Against Crime. I knew they dealt with homicide, families, victims, mothers and stuff. So every time I was off my job, I would go to Ally Group Against Crime and just sit. They knew I was looking for something. So finally one day, you know, my job, I just couldn't do it. You know, God was just speaking to me. God just told me, go ahead. You know, I went back for a month and he told me, you know, I got you. Go ahead and do it. I remember the last day I was there, I turned my machine off and I remember my gesture said, where you go? I walked straight to human resource. I knocked on the door. He told me, come in. I thanked him for the opportunity that they had gave me. I said, as of this day and time, I can no longer work here. It was 9 o'clock that morning. He asked me, can you finish your shift? I said, I can't finish my shift. I remember cleaning my locker out, getting in my car, driving off a lot. I felt so free. I trusted God. I knew God had me. I didn't know how he was going to do it, but the trust in him. See, he loved me again once again when I couldn't love myself. So going to the Ally Group Against Crime, sitting there. And so one morning I came up, this young lady worked there. She said, I seen some. I think that there's something that you're looking for. She told me she sent a lady named Dorothy Johnson Spike. A sort of mothers in charge in Philadelphia. She sent her on the morning show. And so I looked up Ms. Dorothy Johnson Spike and I got in touch with her and we started talking. And I was telling, she was just telling me I can do it here in my city, at Kansas City. So remember Mr. Brooks, Alvin Brooks bringing her to Kansas City for 3 days. She worked with her for 3 days. She said, just take your community and just do what you need to do. You know what, you know, whatever you need to do, you know your community better than I do. So I remember my first thing was to build relationships. And that's how I was able to go to talk on the homicide scenes. You know, once again, I say this again, I never did anything that felt so right in my life. Being there to help a mother, to walk her through the process, even when she's going to bury her loved one. I sit the table at the funeral homes. I'm the liaison between the families and the funeral home director. I'm there when the mother needs to view her child, her loved one, or family when they first get them to the funeral home. Because after a homicide, the victims, they go to Jackson County Medical Examiner. They do a full autopsy on them. And from there, the families are not able to see them on the scene or see them until they pick up a funeral home of their choice, of their liking. And then that's when they can see their loved one from the funeral home. But walking into this, I tell you, and doing what I'm doing, starting some organization, Mothers in Charge, the core mothers that y'all see, the mothers that helped me do the work, losing their children. Last year, 2020 was the baddest year. When 19, we left at 151 homicides. 2020, it got bad. We had 176 homicides. in our community. That's the best I ever seen it. In 2018, it was 151. So we keep going. We went up. Only year we was down in 2014 was down to 87 homicides. Something was doing. But black on black is best. That is what's going on. We have lost in 2020 last year. We had 176 homicides and 106 was black males. 28 was black females. 23 was white males. I believe 11 was white females and 11 Hispanic males and 8 Hispanic females. And we just, the children that we had lost, the babies we lost. We have a problem. We dealing with, don't know how to deal with conflict. You know, the solution, you know, the fight is real out here. The struggle is real for us to do that. You know, I know people say we're in poverty. So a lot of things is going on, but a lot of things we don't know how to deal with conflict. We're dealing with a lot of mental health issues, a lot of trauma. We put street narcotics on top of that, unaddressed issues that we deal with. But one thing I know, homicide starts in our homes. It starts right there in our homes. We're dealing with underlying issues, but we have to address these. We have to get these addressed. And I just know that for KC Mothers in Charge, the things that we do, that we have a counselor, licensed counselor. One thing I knew that was important for us to do, have counseling. Counsel was very important. In our community, we was raised, if we talked to a therapist, a counselor, we were crazy and we were put on those things. So in our black community, we didn't talk to counselors there. So that's why it's a lot of underlying issues that's going on. But when my son was born, I got counseled for 2.5 years. And each year I would go back when it comes on his birthday, on his anniversary of his death day. So KC Mothers in Charge, we do counsel. We pay up for 5 sessions. For families or for individually to be have counseling. We contracted Dr. Donald Lane that does our counseling session. And also I started up another program called Hope and Healing. And see, I wanted to speak life. You know, you have to be careful what you speak into existence, how you say things. So I named it Hope and Healing because we have hope that we can heal and we can live through the process, which we're doing. We have it every third Thursday at our office location, the Robert J. Mohawk Linwood Multipurpose Center from 5 to 7. And what we do for the first hour, we come together as mothers, grandmothers, fathers, families that have been victimized. And we talk about how we feel. We cry if we want to, we scream. That's a moment that we come together. Because when you come from, if you lose a loved one, a child, a loved one, you know, what family go back to what's normal. And it seemed like they tell you, you know, I know my sister, she didn't understand, you know, and she told me that she think I'm just stop doing visual, stop doing birthday anniversary for Pee Wee and stuff. And I told her, no, I shouldn't. Because you can't just act like they didn't exist. We have to live through this and through the process, and remembering them is to keep them in your life, in your heart, so you can live. And so that's one thing. Hope and Healing is really, really important. So the second hour, at 6 o'clock, I bring someone who was a part of the investigation process. Like, we got homicide sergeant coming in March at KC Mothers in Charge and tell the whole process when they get the case, how she give out for her men and women to do the investigation process when they're out there. So we have crime scene lab, we have the judges, we have the prosecutor, Jean Peter Baker, she comes, and we give the families everything that they needed, all the questions, the things that came to their mind when they were going through the process, and you forget, but when everything is over and all these things are coming back to your mind, you need someone to help you process. So that's what we do at KC Mothers in Charge. I have 7 core mothers. I have a new core mother just joined on our first meeting tomorrow. Every first Thursday, we have a core mothers meeting. And they're the mothers that help me do the work that you've seen on the slide. I just, whatever questions that, than you have for me to speak about. I'm open to speak about it, but I tell you, I've never did something in my life that felt so right. Support my community to do what I'm doing. I just do even more than just homicide. I do whatever is needed for me to do. Anybody will call me if somebody's missing, if someone has been shot. I do whatever I need to do to help someone, because I needed that. I needed someone to help me. And God prepared people. You know, for me, I tell people, I say this over and over, I never did something that feels so right. See, I'm walking in my purpose. And, you know, I just sacrificed my child. But I'm telling you, God prepared me for this, for me to do this work, for me to help someone, to save someone's child or loved one's life. And it's been a blessing to be in a community that have God open. Every door I touch, God has opened up for me. I just thank all the support I get, you know, in the community. But it's all of our problem. It's all. Today we stand at 14 homicides. This time last year we was at 19 homicides. We're on track, as we are. Last year, we're down a few, but we still got too many this year already to be starting already in 21 at 14 homicides. So I just, you know, want to just open up if y'all like me to open up any questions you have. I know I'm wrapping it up.
Rosalyn, thank you so much. I mentioned that earlier that I wouldn't want to cut you off because I could listen to you all night. I know I told you this yesterday, but I'm going to publicly say it again, that, you know, I met you through my son, who was working for junior board when he was in at Visitation, and he came home and told me about you and about Mothers in Charge, and he was so excited about it. And when I think about, when I think about us as Christians, one of the questions was about your faith life, and clearly you have answered that you have quite a relationship with God. And I think as Christians, you know, we're Good Friday to Easter people. We have to, you know, when we go through the Good Friday, we can make it to Easter, and we have to do that together. And watching my son see that in action through you, that really happened. I mean, we talk about it, you know, in our faith life, but to have somebody, him witness somebody that has been through such a tragedy, but turned that into such an Easter Sunday moment for so many different people. So I personally want to thank you for that.
You are so welcome, you know, and it's a blessing to be able to help someone, for your son to be able to get some out of that as a young man, and to be able to use that and remember. That's the whole purpose of this whole purpose for me, to be able to help create some things that are going to happen that they can be able to go out and help someone else. And that's what I think I did for, it's been a blessing for Visitation, the junior board, to come, and when they did that, I just really enjoyed working with them. I really did.
Well, you made quite an impact on them, I know. But I know that Steve can answer or speak to that as well. But going with that theme, kind of listening, a lot of the questions that are coming through, of course, when people see this and hear this, they want to help too. And so how do we do that? You know, there's people that ask, you know, we're counselors, how can we help? There are people that say, yeah, you know, we're teachers and educators, how do we help? And there's also a couple of questions that are concerned. You know, one of the questions is, you know, we're predominantly white congregation. How can we help? Do you think inner city families would be comfortable with us? I think that you sort of mentioned that too about, I mean, it probably goes in the conversation too about mother to, you know, you are mother to mother, people who have gone through this. So you help each other. And you're right. We will, you know, some of us will never know what that feels like. So how do we help on the outskirts of that pain? How can we do that?
Well, I need more counselors, you know, because I think our counselors is definitely picking up. I think people are definitely wanting the counseling, because that's one thing I'm real big on telling, you know, counseling is good for you, you know, and when you have somebody just to listen to you. And for me, it was just, I ramble with the Dr. Lane for a minute, and I would say, what you think about it? You know, and he was like, okay, Ms. Temple, because my family, people just gonna understand. I think after you lose a child, you get so misunderstood, because your feelings are everywhere. And a piece of you has been just took, was snatched from you without your permission. So it's a violation. And so I dealt with a heart attack in the process of, after my son was murdered a couple of years, you know, and the doctor told me I was suffering from a broken heart, you know, and I know it's God, because I had from having a stent put in August, Then coming up on November, another year in 2013, on my son's homicide, and I had a whole massive heart attack, and I was in ICU. They didn't think I was going to make it. I woke up 4 days later, and he told me I was suffering from a broken heart. So I know that God prepared me for this. But I think that counseling, we need, if you have counselors, we need to really sit down and we need more counselors. Okay. You know, and I think that we need volunteers, you know, and you don't, we don't want you to have to go through what we've been through. That's a pain that we don't want anyone to go through. So we need volunteers and counsel, people just to be there in the presence. Like I said, sometimes your presence is so much. And it shows us that we care. It shows, you know, because we all want to be community. No one is exempt from homicide, but it's happened so often in this inner city because no one wants to stand up. No one wants to realize that it starts in our home. We have to address our children in our homes.
Having said that, there are a couple other questions about that too, about, you know, you have a pretty broad picture, probably broader than most people, especially about your relationship with the police. I don't think, you know, for me, it was kind of new information. It was some really good insight into the relationship between you and the police department, especially them coming in, trying to tell the process for the, you know, the victim's families. And I thought that was a great thing. What a couple of the questions was, do you see patterns of, are there ways that we can prevent this when we, you know, can we intervene earlier with people? Are some of the people that are the perpetrators of these, you know, that commit the murders, are there ways to interrupt earlier? You know, there are ways that we can help with that. And then, for instance, are there, somebody specifically asked, are there conflict resolution programs that we can get involved in that might ward off some of this plague that we're going through right now?
It's definitely a conflict resolution organization that's, I think they were, I won't say location one building, they definitely do conflict resolution. I think the relationship with the police department has been a great thing because, you know, like I said before, I felt the same way. I don't want to see the police, you know, because when you're not doing the right things, no one wants to see the law. Because when you're not being of the law. And so I think that it is different ways that we can prevent it. But one, the main way, it starts in our homes. Because, you know, Kansas City is a small community. It's not as large as a lot of communities. Like, we have 12 different other Mothers in Charge chapters national. And, you know, I'm looking at Philadelphia. My founder last year, they left out at 2,000 homicides, 2,000 shootings and 500 homicides in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. That's a problem, mm-hmm. You know, and so everywhere went up, you know. So I see that, but it's a problem that we as a community, it's a community problem. Because when we come from a long time ago, it was a village where other people will say something to your kids. It's a community, but we know these perpetrators. It makes it be the same names we hear over and over from the police department, from the streets that's committing these crimes. And families know their loved ones, their family members are out here committing these crimes until we start speaking up and stop being in fear, you know. I get the fear tactic, but you got to be in fear because they're still in the streets and they're going to do it again to someone else. So you got to turn the fear around and being in fear, I'm not going to tell on them. But I'm going to be in fear because I got the ticker. They're still out here around our children going to school and they're still lurking and they're going to do it again. So we got to be in fear to turn them in. Even with the Crime Stoppers tips hotline, 25,000 they went up, you know. So that's, you know, that's some pretty good money, you know, to get a new start, and they are paying out of people, people got to be more educated about it. It is anonymous. It's definitely anonymous.
Okay. The tip is definitely anonymous.
It's definitely so anonymous. Yes. Mm-hmm. They definitely can trust that. Because I can get some, if anybody don't believe, I got resources. I got my outreach specialist, Teresa Murray. She can tell you about how to do it, everything. We got educated on that. It really is anonymous.
Okay. Looking at, there's a couple more questions that are coming in. I think people are looking for pretty specific ways to help you. One of the questions too was if you could maybe share how, you know, the process that you go through, and maybe that would include some of the ways that we get involved along the way. So how do you escort somebody from the time when you're called to meet with them And then how do you touched on some of the process, but could you give us a kind of an overview of what that process
when I'm called out to
general looks like, and then where do the volunteers kind of come in specifically so they can people can get an idea of where they might be able to help the best?
When I'm called out to a homicide, you're saying?
Mm-hmm.
When I'm called out to a homicide, I'm called out anytime day or night from the sergeant of murder squad. They are 2 weeks rotation. They have their squad of 8 men and women on the squad. So they call out. When they get the call, they call me and I go out to the scenes. Sometimes the family's there. Sometimes the family's not. Family don't know it has happened. But I'm there standing the gap for that family because I know someone loved that loved one. So when after it happened, the Kansas City Police Department would send me the next of kin, whoever's the head of the loved one. They would send me the loved one's name, the age, everything, phone number. So I will call the next of kin, tell them who I am, Casey Mother's in charge. Want to reach out to them. So what we do, we always try to take a hot meal. And we use our prize shop on Brookside. That is one of our, they really have supported us. We buy meal from them, and we also get toiletry. We get some paper towels, toilet paper, and a case of water, and we take it out and we talk to. I talk to the family, I do like a small intake, and that's when the families have asked. They ask me, you know, where the loved ones at. I can tell them at the medical examiner, and I can get them to call the medical examiner, get them released, find out what funeral home. Sometimes I do all the work for them, and I walk them through that whole process. But basically, we need like four like. Helping, you know, if we have anyone volunteer want to help out, going out with us and take it's a volunteer. You can be a core mother and not have lost anyone. You don't have to. You could core mothers are volunteers also, so you also can join the core mother to work with us. Because I have trained, I do training on that. I do training, okay. Storytelling training, but also we call over 300 to 400 families weekly. So we're looking for someone to come into the office between Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and make phone calls and call the families. We check on them, then we let them know what's going on about the hope and healing, what date that's on. No, it's every third Thursday, but who we got coming in. We just call them because, like I said, once a homicide occurred, your family member, people go back to what's normal. And people grieving, they have hard times, you know, and no one to talk to because people... And they get tired. Of, so they get tired of hearing about it, you know. But we, as that mother, as that loved one, you just can't. So we need people to make phone calls. We also have need volunteers that set up tables. Once we go back to what's normal, we have events. They go out and set up events, do informational tables for Casey Mothers in Charge. And we train to do that. You know, we train volunteers to do that. But volunteers come and help us out. They help us out of Hope and Healing. We have like different foods sometimes. They have help. They be there sign the families that's coming in. So it's a lot of volunteers opportunity. We do canvassing in the community where we go make stop the violence. So we do it. That's a lot of volunteers out there doing that with us also.
Good. Those were really examples. Thank you.
You're
and
welcome.
Then another question that had come up, I mean, this would be shifting gears quite a bit right now. You had mentioned about being core mothers and with the Casey Mothers in Charge. Somebody asked the question, what about the fathers? Where are the fathers and how do we engage the fathers? And can you speak to that a little bit?
Yeah, Mothers in Charge is mothers, grandmothers, fathers, aunts, family. We just don't have no fathers that want to join.
Okay.
We don't exclude fathers. No, we service fathers. We got a couple of brothers and fathers. They get counseled. They come to the Hope and Healing support. So yeah, they can be a part just as much as just called Mothers in Charge. That's all.
Okay. So
yes.
Is there anything else that you want us to know before evening? Is what are the other things the questions that I'm not asking that I should be asking?
Well, you know, I want to talk about the protest this year we had, you know.
Okay.
I really want to talk about that. You know, we had a protest. Yes, I believe in the protest with George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and, you know, all this unrest, you know, officers doing things they shouldn't be. Yes, we got bad seats in every organization. You know, I believe it's some in KCPD, you know. But see, what we have to address that. We can't allow people to know. It's the same thing in the community. We're asking the community to address their issues, address the violent people out here. Same way we got to address the people that's inside in positions and in law enforcement thing. But see, my protest is my community. See, as we had that protest on the plaza, when all the PD, all every officer they had was out there, even they had the homicide detectives, we still had homicides going on. And I was called to homicide with the homicide team would have to leave the protest line off the plaza because of the homicide scene. So my protest, I believe in the protest. I get it, you know, understand it. But until we as Black people, and I say this all the time in my community, until we as Black people address us, we got to address us, because if people see us kill each other every day, they think, oh, it don't matter. It matters to me. And so that's why I keep doing what I'm doing. But we have to address us, because things can change and they will change, but change starts with us and it definitely starts inside. So as people address the people that's in position, we gotta address the people that's out there. So my protest is the streets. You know, it's my community. Because they die every day in numbers. Mm-hmm. You know, it's been so bad where I've been to 3 homicides in one day. We at one homicide, we call to another. We run different homicides to different homicides. And I've seen where the medical examiner said at 30 gunshot wounds, they just stopped counting on one person. That's a problem. So I gotta address my people right now. And I address other things as they come along. I don't think I'm just gonna turn my head on any police officer or anything. Yes, I believe it happened. I believe it's happening. But until we dress, we got some stuff to dress within. And then we can come together and dress without too.
There's so many things. A couple of things that we're talking about. So people are we're going to send an email out with the information that you're given. So we'll probably be a little bit more specific about how they contact you and how they can volunteer and the jobs that they can do. I love what you said about the protest, about how, you know, I mean, we have these kind of moments where we're all engaged, but man, it's going on even when we're not, you know, and people have kind of moved on. And I think that that's your most, what I heard too. I know that you're on the scene, but one of the most important things is when everybody goes back to normal and your normal isn't anymore. And so that you stay with them and go through the process with them, because you had mentioned about how it's so true. Like, you know, when you lose somebody, you're in shock and you don't know what has happened. You know,
I look at Breonna Taylor and George Floyd, and you know, it was all the other people that got was murdered by police officers. People was everywhere, but now everybody going back to normal.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, so where the family still grieve, you know, and I'm saying you can give money, whatever. Money don't take away that hurt and that pain, that mm-hmm. loss of that one. See, we have to stop this from happening. So it won't happen to no one else. And in every area, we got to do the prevention part in every piece with the police department, police officers, whoever else we're doing in our communities.
Mm-hmm.
We got to fight together for everything. But we have to start in places. We just can't just be everywhere. Jumping, and you see people jump to, and I call it a hot topic. I say, like, okay, that's a hot topic. So even when, you know, and one thing that really gets me in my community, we see every day young adults are getting murdered. Why we don't think it's gonna happen to a baby? I remember, I'm gonna go back to 2013, Maya White and Maisha Turner on 55th and Wabash. There was one of the cases that just almost destroyed me, which Maisha Turner was my son's friend. Her mother helped me with my son's funeral. She was found in her apartment with her 3-year-old murder, and then her little youngest son, 1 year old, walking around. And we said, when we allow that little girl, especially that baby homicide, to go inside the mother and child, it was gonna be more, and it has been more.
Mm-hmm.
So while we don't think, when we see people dying every day, and then it's gonna happen to a baby again. So then it happened to a baby, everybody's out there, then within a couple of weeks or a month, they gone right back to the same thing they've been doing. We got to address that. If we don't stop it before, when it happened to grown-ups, young adults, so it won't get to babies. Because I remember back in my days, it was a code of respect. When I was coming up, they didn't kill women and children.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So where people should contact me at? I'm at the Robert J. Mohawk and Neighborhood Multipurpose Center. Our office number is 816-912-2601. Call, we open from Monday to Thursday from 9 to 4:30. Have a hotline number, because it's a must. I really need help.
Okay.
816-606-8118.
And once again, we'll send this information out in emails to our community. And then also we're gonna pull up the screen too. I'm gonna be pretty blunt about the fact of the matter that any agency to run needs the money. And so we are once again gonna ask for some donations to Casey Mothers in Charge on your behalf. And so we're gonna pull that screen up again. We're gonna, you have told us that you would end our evening in prayer, which we appreciate. But one of the last questions that I would like to ask is, where do you see hope?
Where I see hope? I see hope. I see hope in God. See, God is real. Once we pull it together and we surrender our will, you know, I can't tell for who.
I think so. I can't see. We may have had Rosalyn actually log off, so we're going to try to get her back. But once again, I wanted to tell everybody to remind you that we will send this information. You can get in charge or get in touch with Karen Miller too. She can direct you on ways to volunteer as well. But we'll get this information out into an email for everybody. Also, I'm going to just give a couple minutes just to see if we can get Rosalyn back on because she was going to take. Oh, here she comes. There you go. Great. Rosalyn, I think we got cut off somehow. Might be muted as well. There we go.
Can you hear me?
Yep, now
I'm
again.
My computer is locked up. I don't, but.
That's okay. I'm a teacher. Welcome to my world right now. So you were talking to us about hope and our hope and your hope in God. And then you were going to lead us in prayer to end the evening.
Yeah, hope is this. We have to trust in God. We definitely got to pray and speak life into in our community, life into people. I know it's hope. I know things are, it's going to change. I know we went through a pandemic and, you know, nothing happened without God allowing it. So I don't know who they're getting away with somebody doing things without him. He allowed everything that we're going through. So the hope is to trust in him and keep having faith. Things are going to look better, much better.
I love how you said that. He said, try my way and you'll never look back.
Never look back, yes. So I close in prayer. Can we bow our heads? Father God, we come to you. We said, thank you for this evening, Lord. We just thank you, God, for all that you have done, all that you're gonna do, God. We thank you, Lord, for the Visitation, St. Francis. We thank you for everyone that was a part of this hunger program, God. We just thank you, Lord, for Mothers in Charge. We thank you, God, what you're doing with this organization, the strength that you have gave me, the passion and the gift and my purpose, God. We just ask that you just lift us up, lift our community up, God. We need you, God. Just protect us, protect our homes and our children, God. Cover us like never before, God. But Lord, we know that, God, you is God all by yourself. You need none of our help, God. We just ask that we just stand on you, your word. We trust in you, God. Take care of everyone, God, and just give them travel and mercy, God. Just give them the strength and give them the peace that they desire, Lord. Bless all the core mothers, the volunteers that we have, God. But Lord, we ask that you bring more people on to helping you. We thank you for all the people as a part of this program, God. We give you all the glory, praise, and honor to do your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
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 Rosalyn, thank you so much. It's an honor. I would, you know, sit at your feet and listen to you for hours and hours. Thank you for what you're doing. I join you in your mourning for your grief for your son. But I appreciate all that you have done to turn that into something for so many people. And I think that I speak for our entire community. We thank you from the bottom of our hearts for the work that you're doing. So
thank you also for having me. Thank you.
Okay. And we will be in touch for sure. Okay. So.